Okay. My name is Roman Novik. I represent EPAM data practice here, more precisely, Big Data Competency Center. And today I will tell you a couple of interesting facts about how to productionize data platforms. Of course, there are a lot of tricks and best practices here in this area, but self-service is one of the most important here. I mean, the most demanding and the most visible and faceted for customer. This is my contacts, Skype, LinkedIn. You can write me to reach me after this session. If any questions will appear and you will not be able to ask during Q&A session. Okay, this slide about evolution of requirements. Customer on the market becomes more and more capricious. First of all, several years ago, demand was for big data, then big and fast data, then big and fast and smart and hard and reactive data. And with time, stack infrastructure becomes more mature and mature. And now all things, all tricks becomes more accessible. And now customers want exploratory environment, self-service, I don't know, so different capabilities for digitalization of the platform, integration, cooperation with third-party vendors, and we invent new things to address all this demand from the customer side. And today we'll talk about the two cubes, the most advanced in terms of requirements from the customer side. This is about productionalization. What is self-service definition? In fact, this is like a harmonization of relationships between different stakeholders who participate, who deal with data platform. Usually, and of course, the main goal is to optimize, to speed up business, to make business more data-driven, more use cases-driven. How usually it looks like this process, I mean, dealing with data platform. There are some business users, data analysts, when they want to see, to play with data, to run some analytics, to count statistics, usually such data citizens, let's say, go to service desk. Service desk usually creates different tickets. Okay, if data is available and accessible, your request can be served pretty fast. But if not, new tickets are created for developers, for operations. Usually it takes time, and of course it makes business like a fixed, not so mobile as it used to be. And it deprives you from your competitive things and speed the first. What we request from self-service usually? The first and the very important thing, this is autonomy. It means no calls for support, for operations, for L2, 3 support. User and data citizen should be autonomous in this meaning. Next, this is full lifecycle support. It means that everything should be automated in self-service, and again, it will allow user to deal with data, with infrastructure, with compute power, without calling operations, DevOps, and without these delays, right? And it means infrastructure is a code, is mandatory prerequisite for self-service to enable such behavior. Hybrid cloud, Scenario support is also highly demanded. This is usual example when, for example, some customers want to not be focused and tied to a specific cloud vendor. And this is usual case when somebody wants to use Azure ML for serving some data requests, but data itself, models and save itself should be located, for example, in the cloud of Google and train it on VMs, TPUs of Google, for example. This is usual case. And also modern self-service platforms should support such features. Data governance workflows and two layers self-service for developers and for data citizens. And I will tell you about it right now. This is typical data platform. We will not emphasize data aspect here, just two very important things. Usually data platform consists of foundation, right? It's like a, we will run briefly through all these cubes. Just listen to me for now. Gray cubes. This is foundation part. And of course, it should include some kind of centralized security, centralized ingestion, centralized monitoring, centralized scheduling and orchestration framework. And everything makes like a foundation of the platform. It should be shared cross-cutting components. And on this platform, we can build different applications. Application can be can include any functionality built using any technology platform, but of course any application should go to one point of truth to be identified, to be for authorization, authentication. It should report to one data governance and one monitoring area to register different data sources, whatever. And to make this platform, which part of, let's say, self-service we can distinguish here? The first, this is exploratory environment and self-service. This is classical part of self-service when data citizen, people who want to deal with data to run analytics, in autonomic mode, they go here. And another part is self-service for developers, because developers also should, they suffer from these delays. I mean, asking support or platform team to provide new APIs, to provide, to publish new data, and takes time. And of course, some enablement of some self-service for developers also speed up any business, any such kind of process. And as we distinguish these two layers of self-service, let's talk first of all about self-service for developers, because self-service for data citizens can be built upon. The self-service. The first layer of self-service is for developers. This is like an explanation of what I mean, saying that any application under the roof of our platform is like a built upon foundation. You can see that your platform can contain platform as a service component, infrastructure as a service components, even on-premises components. It can be cluster, it can be a web application, it can be Docker with some business logic included. In this term, in this meaning, all this even big data clusters, computation cluster, Kubernetes, whatever, can be treated as microservice in terms of this data platform, right? Because microservice, it's not about the size, definitely. It's about isolation. right? Isolation of some business function, clear definition of input-output interfaces, contracts, and so on and so forth. And this is typical data platform in the cloud. And developers, again, developers of any of this application, of any of this component within this platform, should also have this mobility, this dynamicity, which self-service provides. A couple of words about it. The first case, when we talk about self-service for developers, we mean that, for example, some business unit which want to enable self-service, it should have control over budget in the cloud, right? It should, for example, have access to some registry of allowed services like Hadoop cluster, HD Insight in Azure, EMR cluster in Amazon, whatever. Azure ML, Databricks, whatever. This business unit should access provision allowed service, like press a button, service resource should be provisioned, and business unit will receive like a connection strings, whatever, to access this resource without any calling to support. Another use case here, it's when business unit wants to onboard new developers, users to this sandbox, let's say developer sandbox. Again, it should have API to call some service and get new users without calling to L2 support, L1 support, whatever. It allows and enables isolation and decoupling, right? So external isolation. And one of the most brilliant things here is isolation of teams between, from each other, and isolation of application teams from platform team, because they are connected through contracts and not more. And everything is automated. Clearly defined boundaries of responsibilities. Again, when we work through contracts, we know segregation of, we understand that we are segregated, we know area of our responsibility and our control. And absence of dependencies via ticket system, which causes delay. And how to build such kind of self-service, which allows application teams to work and deal independently and in self-service mode. The first, this is APIs. As I said, as I already said, this is about contracts, defining clear contracts of all components of the data platform. Here you can see, like on the bottom, you can see all previously mentioned components of data platform, like security, data governance, data ingestion, scheduling orchestration, monitoring. On the right side, you can see applications, which also can expose own APIs and provide access to own functions, business logic, and so on and so forth. And everything is managed by some kind of API management platform. And this segregation and exposing contracts is the first mandatory prerequisite for enabling such self-service platform. Given that we have access to our functions of our platform, of our foundation, what to do with like how to create and manage resources. For example, if I want to instantiate some warehouse to load data there, to provision some BI tool, to build report, to understand something, how to create and manage such resources, how to assign different quotas, access control lists, different tags for billing. Everything should follow like an enterprise notation, naming convention, right? How to monitor everything and raise alerts, for example, if budget was exceeded. Self-service, this is like a thing when you should clearly distinguish which user, which department, how many they spend. And this granularity is critical for self-service because of when in the end of month you get a bill, $5 million, you want to understand who spent, who over budgeted you. And this monitoring, proper tagging of all resources is critical. And the receipt here is one of components which is provisioning API. Usually we built it on top of Open Service Broker API. This is a component which was invented initially by a pivotal company to enable deployment and integration their cloud foundries to another platforms to deliver this component and integrate with vendors' platforms like IBM Cloud, whatever, Google Cloud, and so on and so forth. Indeed, this is like a standardization of registry to publish information about any services which are available and operations which can be launched against those services. Doesn't matter this is physical resource like a database or any service. Or virtual resource, for example, range of rows in this database, right? This is catalog of resources which are available for provisioning, for further using as self-service. I will show you exact precise diagram how to build such self-service, but one important note here that in Spring ecosystem we have accelerator which allows to use this standard, this open API standard easily. It's called Spring Cloud Open Service Broker. It already implement a lot of contracts, which allows you just to inject any type of business logic easily and react on different actions, like a customer asks your service about catalog, about list of available services. You take it from somewhere, for example, even from XML file or in memory or database, and return it back to user. Customer asks to perform some operation, again you handle this request and perform proxy this operation further. Okay, what's next? Indeed, we have automation frameworks, any cloud vendor has such option provided for user, and if you are talking about Azure, this is Azure automation. If you are talking about Amazon, this is CloudFormation. Those services allows us to automate this provisioning process. And of course, it allows to expose API for management, to call from outside any requested function. And altogether, too small and unclear text here. Let me show you this diagram. This is like a final to be state, how this architecture should like. In the center, you can see this is Open Service Broker API. It publishes two endpoints. The first, catalog of services. I already described it. It can be physical resources. It can be some virtual resources. And also, this application has like an endpoint for operations to run operations against published resources. On the right, you can see this is just an API gateway, firewall, any components which should exist in exist for our application to make it production ready. And user just pings your service asking, okay, which services do you have? Hadoop, Databricks, ML as resources, or it can be virtual service like ETL to offload data from somewhere and place it in your sandbox for drilling data, for counting statistics, whatever. And you can see that it's not more than web application, and the main benefit of it is just a standardization. This is standard like Open API. This is, again, notation Open Service Broker API. But it proxies real requests to your infrastructure via some automation framework. I already mentioned it can be Azure automation or Amazon CloudFormation, whatever. Why we should control this process? Because, again, even if user asks to provision some cluster, you should the first create it to assign different quotas, security policies, to set up monitoring. The first of all, monitoring on top of expenses, on top of budget. You should create monitoring about usage to handle activities which are done by user. And another infrastructure operations which are necessary for dealing with your resources. And everything is done behind the scene. It's transparent for user. It just can run curl or console if you will implement it, or even you can deliver to user SDK. And in this term, it behaves like any cloud, right? Like a platform as a service. But the main differentiator here is that it accelerates your business, and you already implement some best practices. You implement all the things following your corporate standards, security requirements, and so on and so forth. And you publish this function to user for use. And okay, it was like a self-service for developer. Of course, a very important note here is that we see that such kind of self-service, such kind of proxy, let's say, should not be the only entrance to your environment. It should be like an accelerator. Why? we should provide another types of access, like a standard portal or standard SDK, which Azure and Amazon provides. Because if you will hide new capabilities of the cloud behind your proxy, again, you will slow down your business, because you always any vendor will develop its platform faster than you will adopt your self-service for new versions, for new features, and we should not delay delivery of these new features to a business. But again, as some accelerator, self-service again, it's very useful. And on top of this self-service for developers, which is depicted here on the left part of this picture, we can build easily self-service for data citizens, right? Because the only thing which should be added is just a data catalog, the registry of logical data assets you have. And data user can query your self-service directly via web portal, console, curl, whatever, or as in legacy world, this user can create a ticket or call to support, and again, it will be proxied to your platform. So this is how we distinguish these two types of self-service for developer and data citizen. And finally, this is mapping to our platform. On the top, you can see that this is compute. It can be mapped to our infrastructure, platform as a service, which we allow to use as self-service component. This is data platform, data layer, where our data assets are storage. This is shared storage component. Data catalog, data governance also is depicted and bracketed to this foundation. And self-service itself as API, this is part of API and facades of our platform. That's it. This is how we use it. This picture is from our real project. It's not like a theory. And this is one of our best practices for productionizing data platforms. Questions? Yeah.
To services bypassing the open service protocol.
Yeah.
Makes us possible to control such things like budget spending, for example.
No.
We have to intercept every single movement inside our platform in order to understand that some resources used by some.
In fact, no. Absolutely agree with you that we should not leave some uncontrolled part of the cloud, and users who want to bypass our proxy, it can follow legacy scheme flow to go to support, to ask to provision new service. But again, this is not uncontrolled process. It's just slower, but it gives users access to new capabilities of the cloud. For example, new service will appear every reInvent, every Ignite, every such event introduces dozens of new, brand new services. And of course, some business units, some research innovators in your company will want to use it immediately. And this user will not want to wait your release cycle, which can last for weeks, for months, or even years. But of course, it should not be uncontrolled. Yes, any modern state of clouds allows, for example, if you are talking Azure, here we can set up subscription level policies for security, for monitoring. It's possible now, and any vendor allows it. GCP, Amazon, whatever. You can like set up global policies which are working by default and cannot be changed by users. At least security policies, monitoring policies, whatever. Here it's like, a ready receipt which accelerate you. For example, you can already implement some ETL to offload data from raw area to your sandbox for further drilling this data. And you can do it like a push and button. And you will not wait this flow, usual flow, I mean support, developer requests, their release cycle. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You should go to support, right? Or you can like just click somewhere. Because in the second case, it's kind of it's not obvious how can we enforce like I don't know name schema. Is it possible?
Again, if you as enterprise architect, as solution architect of your data platform, see necessity to fix them. Contract. Of course, you can close this from usual access and implement your business logic, your policies, and hide it. Again, it's like a common sense, right? Technical facilities again. Okay, well, definitely you can. If you have control on your Active Directory, you can ban any activity except you want to publish. Again, it can be impersonation, this is known issue, right? Even when you're working with HD Insight or EMR, any task against data is launched under service principle of this cluster. And impersonation should be implemented for audit, for example, for security audit, should be implemented additionally. It's like a customization. You should intercept and map request to your cluster and understand which data is affected and build your own monitoring system. Databricks, HD Insight, EMR, whatever, they do not allow to proxy transparently requests from user to real infrastructure. We should understand it, and again, this is customization of your platform. And if this is critical for you, of course, this is such kind of Self-service also allow to enforce this audit.
Second thing, describe the way to isolate application teams from platform teams. On the other hand, there should be some ways which are not reflected in your presentation to, for example, to get the feedback from application teams to platform teams, because there should be some but probably some additional requests or some notes about usage of platform services by application developers. In this case, probably application developers should be aware what happens behind the scene, what happens behind the service broker, in order to have more reasoned proposals or notes of people.
Why not? You can, again, you can expose a logging component itself as a service of this platform, available for review in logs, for instrumentation, whatever. But what is important here, the best practice dictate to do it to allow user to access data components not as root, right? As usual, limited user.
I used to encourage application developers to participate in evolving the platform. For example, in your scheme, when you segregate those two functions, it means that application developers will never be able to influence fast development of the platform.
I don't understand why. Developer application team will have access to their components they requested, like a Hadoop cluster, Kubernetes cluster, whatever. They will be able to monitor it, to make a decision what is like a bottleneck or which component is broken, buggy, and so on and so forth. And so application team can submit feedbacks to platform team.
Can they submit?
Submit what?
For example, when my proposal
is
feedback or bug report.
Why not?
But my proposal is to some ready-to-use fix to the platform.
Why not? It depends on how you shape your platform, which responsibilities and relations exist between teams, platform team, application team. If you allow them to review your code, to understand what is happening, to submit pull request, to fix some bugs. This is not limited by this architecture. I mean, this architecture, it's like an accelerator, which allows to automate typical activities and enforce some policies, for example. Okay, more questions? Definitely, productionizing of data platform contains more receipts, like APIs, data cataloging, marketplace, internal, external, whatever. This is one of receipts, how to productionize, how to increase involvement of employees of the company for working with the data, because it's typical request from any CIO, CTO, CEO of companies we are working with, who are claiming like, we spent millions of dollars on data platforms, and only just a few people from my company can access this data, right? How to request for democratizing data platform, this is typical demand from business now. And all these things allow to extend this audience of people, of employees who can use benefits from data, from analytics, and so on and so forth. And that's why it's too actual right now. Again, as I showed on my first slide, demand on new features grows from business, from market, and because modern technology stack allows it, it becomes more mature. You can stretch a slider and ramp up your cluster to scale it. And of course, if such things are already automated, you can spend budget on next step of automatization, and it allows to do it. So this is main idea of my presentation. Thank you for your attention.